that we use C out, that is character output. This is a character output. This is something that has been already included in iOS stream. We are using that. This is the insertion operator, and we are printing C out. So we are printing hello world. This was the quick revision of how we printed something on the console. Anyone has any doubt, you can ask it in the question and answer session, section. Guys, I'm going a bit fast because these things were covered in the last session, but still, if you guys have any doubt, please ask. Please don't shy away to ask, and there is no question such as a silly question. So even if you feel that it sounds silly, please don't hesitate to ask. I had a question that if we code a program in Windows and write the same code in iOS, do the code still work? Yeah, if you have a C++ compiler, it should work, right? Advait, can you help me on this? Because I personally feel that it will work. Or Gavro, maybe. Yeah, it would work, Ruthvich. Not in C++. Nisarga, can you exactly tell what are you saying? Not in C++. What do you mean by that? Okay, guys, you can have what I personally feel is that it would work in iOS 2, but I thought only Python was capable of that. No, I don't think so. Yeah, we can do the same with C++ too. Okay, guys, let's proceed. If anyone has no doubts, then we will go with what was taught in the last session. Okay, so this is how we give the output in on the console. Then there is something called as data types too, right? We have covered this in the last session, but I will quickly revise that. This is something called as a data type. So what happens is that when we write a program, it allocates some memory, right? If we want to have an integer, or maybe we want to perform an addition operation. So let's consider that we want to perform an operation of adding two numbers. So we need to store those two numbers somewhere in memory. So how do we store that? We assign one variable to it. This is the variable. I will just give a good name for it, maybe. Number one. So this is the name of the variable. This is the value that has been assigned. And this is the data type. I will just revise it once more. This is the name of the variable. This is the value. And this is the data type. So what the value is represents is the value that has been assigned to that particular variable. And what data type is that, there are various data types, such as integer, long, maybe float, character. We will cover each and every data type in this session. But apart from integer, there are other data types too. So we have assigned this value. And there is no need to always assign a value. So we can just take the value from the user. So this is something called as taking the input from the basic thing of a program is to take some input from the user, perform the necessary operations and do all the operations that are required, and provide a result that has been that the programmer desires, right? So let us consider I want to write a program to add a value of 5 to a particular number. So let us consider that, for example, if the user inputs 5, then I will add 5 to it, 5 plus 5, 10, and I will output 10. So how this program would work is that I have initialized one variable, I have taken the input from the user, and I'm outputting the value of number plus 5. So let's compile this and see if this works. Yeah, guys, as you can see, the output has been given and it is 10. So yeah, any doubts till now? This is the insertion operator. This is the output operator. Like, sorry, this is how we insert. This is how we take the input. This is how we give the output on the console. These things you need to remember. Is it going up a bit fast or maybe slow, or are you guys understanding? Because since this was covered in the last session, I thought let's have a quick revision for it. Please write it in the chat box so that I will know if I should maintain the same pace. Yeah, yes, we understand. Okay. Okay, great. So proceeding, this was covered in the last session. So proceeding with the session, let's see what other data types are there, right? So there are some data types called as float. So what integer does is that, so this is how we comment one line. What integer does is that in integer variables, we can only store the values, those are integers, like maybe minus one, minus three, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. These values could be stored in integer variables, but how do we store the value of maybe say let's say that 3.4? This is a decimal value, right? So for storing these kinds of value, we need something called as a float. Float is another data type similar to integer, but it is used to store the values such as decimal values, basically 3.4 maybe. And yeah, we can also print it. Yeah. So yeah, this is how we are printing a float. Similar to that, we have one more data type of character. So these, we were talking about numbers till now, right? Maybe a decimal number or maybe an integer. But how do we store something called as a? This is not a number, right? This is a character. So for that, there is a data type called as char, char. And that's how we store a character, like that. That's how we assign a character to a character variable, and we can output it as well. Okay, so we will go through other data types as well. Just a second. Guys, if you have any doubts, please write it in the chat box or question and answers session.
Hello, can you hear me, Vinod?
Yeah.
Yeah,
Yes,
so
you are.
someone was asking that the code that we are writing, will it work on macOS, right? Yeah,
Yeah,
so
right.
the code we are writing right now, so we are actually using a Linux shell, right? So Linux and macOS both originate from Unix system. Okay, so yeah, so everything we do right now can be done in macOS also, so it's not a problem. Okay. Whereas for Windows, the commands may be a little different. I don't know about that, but you can do the same things in Mac with the same commands.
Right. I also thought the same. Okay. So are you guys able to? Thank you for clearing up. Yeah, are you guys able to see the screen? C++ fundamental data types. Yes, okay. So as you can see, there are data types here. We have covered integer, we have covered float, we have covered character. Then there are these other things that we haven't covered, right? And there is something called as size. So let's see what this is. So double is double floating point, and what is the meaning of that, I will cover it. And bool is boolean, and there is something called as size. So let's address what size is. When we are storing a value in a memory, like for example, I'm assigning one variable integer, integer a equal to 5, it will take some space in my memory, right? And that is called the size of that particular variable. So just a sec. There is some song going on at my side, so you guys can enjoy it or maybe ignore it, because I cannot stop it. It's on the road. So yeah, coming back to it. So this is the an integer takes in the memory location. So it is 2 or 4. So basically, it depends on the compiler. Integer can take a value of like the size of the integer could be 2 bytes as well as 4 bytes. It depends. And it is not like specific. Also, the float takes the size of 4 bytes. Double takes the size of 8 bytes. 8 bytes. And whereas the least number is taken, like least space is taken by characters, that is 1 byte. Also boolean. So yeah. Apart from that, double. So double is double floating point. So there is something called as a range. We had also learned it in the last session. There is something called as a range of a variable. Like for example, integer, just to give an example, this is not a fact. If we consider to have a range, like integer has a range of 100. So that when I assign a value of 101 to an integer variable, it will give an error because the range of the integer was till 100 only. So each data type has a range. Integer also has a range, float also has a range, and double also has a range. So, but the range of integer is not 100, it's much, much more than that. Also, for float, the range is high. To access the values that are beyond the range, we have introduced some other data types such as double. So it can store the variables, it can store the values. Okay, just a second. What I was saying is that it can store the values that are beyond the scope of float. For example, if float has a range of maybe 100, like 100.0, double can access the range that is beyond it, maybe 101.5. For example, just to take an example, it can access the value that even float cannot access. So for that particular reason, the data types such as double were introduced. There is something also called as long. Synonymous to how float and double work. Like for example, if double covers the value that are not beyond, like that are beyond the range of float, right? Similarly, long takes the values that are beyond the scope of an integer. So for that particular reason, long was introduced. We will see how it works, and yeah, that's the main reason of introducing double and long. Apart from that, bool. I will show it in the code what bool is. And void, as you guys might know, it's an empty data type. Like it doesn't represent anything. Like basically, when we don't want to return anything from a function, we use void main for it. So let's see how boolean works now. For example, bool. So boolean is true or false. Only two values could be taken by a boolean variable. So we have assigned the value of true, and we can use these variables to verify some statements. So it would be covered in if else part that would be taken by Yatish, but he will tell how to use this boolean. But yeah, this is one of the data types, and we can print it too, for example. Yeah, as you can see, true has been we have got an output of 1 when we print a boolean of true, because basically true means 1 and false means, let's see what false means, 0. Yeah, so these are the things, like this is called a boolean basically. Okay guys, before teaching the next things, I would just like you guys to write in the chat box how to add, like, Rutvij means void means an empty set, right? Not a set, Rutvij. Void doesn't mean a set, but it represents, it represents nothing. Like, for example, integer, when we return something from a function, we write integer, right? If we don't want to return something from a function, I think void could be better explained when a function has been taught. So I guess just wait for it, because it would be difficult to not give context of functions, what functions are, and explain you void. What's the difference between character and void character? Okay. Yeah, I will cover that. Yeah, before that, guys, can you write it in the chat box? Can you write in the chat box how to initialize two variables and take values from the users and add those two variables, like performing addition of two variables? How you would write? Please write that code in the chat box. It would be of 5 or 6 lines. So that is, we will wait for a couple of minutes till everyone tries their hand at coding, because you guys can see me coding, but you guys have to actually practice it. You can also take the values from, Abhishek, I will repeat. I am saying that we have to take two values from the user, maybe int A and int B, and we have to take these values from user and perform an addition operation of both the numbers. Abhishek, you are writing C in incorrectly. You are using the wrong operator. Cn is written in this style. Guys, everyone should participate in this. We'll wait for a couple of minutes till everyone tries their hand. Just a second. You don't have to write include IO stream. I'm considering that you will always already write that. Is C++ case sensitive? Yes, it is case sensitive, Rucha. Anushka has given correct answer. Yeah, Anushka, you're right. Abhishek, I don't think we can take the variables like that, input of two variables, like say in A comma B, that's not allowed. Srushti has also given correct answer. Yes, Srushti, but you just have to initialize sum first. You just cannot directly assign sum equal to A plus B. You have to initialize the sum first, or else you will get an error. I will show you what error you can get. Does it accept the value in string from user? Depends on how you have initialized the data type rhythm. If you have initialized it as a character, then it would accept it in the character format, not the integer. If you are assigning, like if you are initializing A and B as integers, then it would accept the value as integer. Aditi, yes, you're right. You have also written correctly. Priyanka also, you have written the code correctly. Ritvich, yeah, Ritvich, you are right. Shivendra, yeah, right. Yes, so I guess most of you have got how to add two numbers, right? Yes, great. So we'll be learning about subtraction, division, and multiplication. So these are the fundamental operations. So similar to how you did for addition, we will just try out how multiplication works. So maybe int ab, okay, I will just give good names maybe. Okay, I will just show you if what if you don't initialize it. I guess Priyanka did not initialize the sum maybe. So we are taking the input. And someone did take the input from in this way, which is not allowed because we will get an error. Let's see how we get an error. Right. So there are some errors in this code. We will go through each and every error and see what's wrong in it. Yeah, you can see here in the console that there are two warnings and there are two errors generated. So as a software developer, you don't ever wish to see this thing, something called as error. So we will try to figure it out what the error was. Okay, what's the first error? So use of undeclared identifier called answer, right? So as I mentioned already, that you have to initialize answer first and you just cannot directly store the value in answer, right? So what we will do is that we will write the answer, like we will declare the answer first instead of just assigning the value directly, right? Okay, and now run the code. There would be still one error. Yeah, use of expression result unused. Okay, it wasn't compiled. Okay, it's getting in the loop. I guess this is creating some problem because we are not getting the output, right? But we are also not getting any error for it. That's surprising. Okay, great. Let's see. Definitely, this is not getting compiled because we have written it incorrectly. We will write this correctly and we will get the result. It's still giving some error. Oh, use of undeclared identifier answer. That's a bit strange. Yeah, like we shouldn't get an error for this. Is there something called as a refresh? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so we are getting it correctly. I don't know what the problem was for the last, like we were getting two errors for the answer, even though we had declared answer. So let's see what is happening. It's similar to what you guys have done in the chat box. Like while adding the two numbers, we have just performed a different operation called as multiplication, and we have used this operator for multiplying the two numbers. So we have initialized number one, number two, and answer on the fourth line. We have taken the first input from the user. We have taken the second input from the user. We have multiplied the two numbers, and we have stored the value in this answer. And we have just given the output of what the result was. So it's as simple as that. So similarly, we can perform different operations such as maybe division. But can anyone give me an answer? Like for example, if I'm performing this division operation, if I'm taking the first number input as 5, second number input as 7, what would be the answer when I compile this program? Can anyone guess in the chat box? 0, 1, okay, 1. 5 by 7 equal to 1, Omkar. 0. It's 0, I guess. No one is thinking about decimal, right, Karan? Yeah, because the data type is integer. 0.7, Yogesh. Okay. Int hai na. Right, Aditi. Right. Most of you are right. We will get an int. We will not get a decimal fraction as an output. We will get the output as 0, right? As most of you guys correctly guessed, since we have declared it as an integer, we have declared answer as an integer, we will be getting an answer which is not in decimals. It will be 0 because 5 by 7 in integer is 0, right? What if we want to have the answer in decimal? What changes we need to do? Again, chat box. Typecasting, yeah, that could be one of the thing. Use float, but let's not go to the typecasting. We will teach that later. Float, right. Let's get an answer in decimals. Where are we getting this? Can anyone guess? We have declared the answer in float, but we are still getting this as 0. Int num should also be float. Num and 1 and 2 is also integer. Okay. I will make the changes. It's great to see you guys. Getting the solution. So please keep the chat box active, and those who are not answering, please don't feel shy to answer. What worse could happen? You might be wrong. I'm also learning with you guys. Yeah, so we have finally got an answer in decimals. So what changes we did? We not only initialized answer variable as a float, but we also initialized number one and number two as float, so that when we divide two float numbers and store the answer in a float, we can get an output in the decimal, right? Most of you guys guessed it correctly. Great. Great, guys. So yeah. Now, so most of the things have been covered from my side. I'm just remembering if something is left to cover. No, I guess. Okay, we will just do one or two things before it. We will cover some other operators as well. Just a second. I'm just trying, I don't know if this would work. Right. Okay. This is one more operator. this is one more operator. What I have done is that I am reversing the value of answer. For example, like I had initialized a value of true, right, to answer, and when we know that if we are going to print it, then it would naturally print one, since answer has been assigned a value of true, and when we print it, it naturally prints one. But what this operator does is that it reverses the value, so that it initially changes the value of the output from true to false, and when we try to print it, it prints zero. So this is one of the operators that we hadn't covered till yet. This is called as negation operator, and we reverse the value with the help of this. But these things were like a boolean would mainly be used when we learn about what if and else statements are. So that would be covered after this. Also, there is one more operator that we had covered in the last session, I guess so, but let's see if you guys are familiar with it. Tell me what would be the answer of this. What would be the output, so that I will know if you guys are familiar with this particular operator. Do the int in int main also represents integer, Swaraj? Yes, I will explain you why we write int main.
Vinod, could you please check the question and answer section?
Yeah, sure.
Vinod, will you also cover the increment and decrement operators?
Yeah, I will cover it after this. Rituja, I'm not able to see any question in question and answers. Okay, is C++ case sensitive? Yes, it is case sensitive. Hear the question, Rituja, because I'm not able to see other question after, like, apart from this question.
No, there's no other question than this.
Okay. Okay, yeah, so most of you have answered it. One. Okay, I guess so most of you are familiar with this operator, right? Right. Great. Yeah, this is the modulus operator, and we use it for taking the remainder. Remainder. So when we divide 17 by 4, what's the remainder that we get? That value is stored in this particular variable. So 17 by 4 is like the quotient is 4 and the remainder is 1, right? So the remainder value is stored in this particular variable, and we output this value. So when we run this program, the output would be 1. So similarly, if we are taking some number that is divisible by 4, like maybe 24, the remainder would be 0. Right. So this is one more operator that we have covered. And also, as Yatish said, let's cover what increment and decrement operator is. So for example, you will get to know why when we use this increment and decrement operator, but I will just cover it right now. So for example, let us consider that we have to write, like, it is very boring, right, to write add one number, like add one value to the variable each time. Instead of writing this, we could just write A++, and this is how we increment the value of variable, whatever the value is, by one. For example, integer has been answer has been at assigned a value of 5, right? So when we do A++, it would give 5. But why? Can anyone explain why the increment didn't happen? Anyone in the chat box? I don't expect you guys to know this, but if anyone knows, great. Can anyone explain why the increment didn't, we couldn't see 6 as an output, because 5 if we increment the value of 5 by 1, it should give an output of 6, right? But it is still giving an output of 5. Right, Anushka, Maitri. It will increment in the next line. Right, Kasturi. Post increment, Pritam, right. Since there is something called as post increment, that we are writing plus plus after the variable, right? This is the post increment. What if we write plus plus before and run this now? Right. So this is called as pre increment. So we are incrementing before we give the, before the output thing is work, working. So we are incrementing it before, therefore the value of answer is incremented by 1, and then the output thing works. So therefore we are getting an output of 6 when we do the pre-increment thing, and when we do the post-increment we are getting the same value, because it first outputs the value of answer and then increments it. So therefore we will be getting, let's see, what if we print answer in the next line. Right, okay, 56. Right, the first value that it gives after post increment is 5. Then as the increment thing worked after the output was given, it increments the value of 5 to 6, and then it outputs the value of 6. So therefore we get a value of 6 in, for the final answer. Anyone has any doubt till this? Because it's a bit difficult to understand what pre-increment and post-increment is. No question, guys? No doubt. Okay, great. So yeah, similar to increment operator, there is something called as decrement operator. So as we are incrementing the value by 1, we can also subtract 1 value from it. This is the pre-decrement. So we have reduced the value of answer by 1 by doing by minus minus sign. So this is the decrement operator. And this is pre-decrement. Also similarly, this is post-decrement. Yeah. Right. Apart from that, there are some operators, but we will cover it later, because these are the fundamental operators that you guys should know. Apart from that, we could cover it in the next session, that some other operators that you need to know. Okay, guys, if you have any doubt till this, please mention it in the chat box. Or else we can shift to something else. Gaurav, Advait, Yatish, do you need to cover, should I cover something else too?
No, this was fine. Thanks.
Yeah, great.
Hello, can you hear me, Vinod? Okay, so I wanted to explain one thing that you were showing. Okay, so actually my that repl.it is not working. It's not loading actually, so I will just go.
Okay, shall I write the code for you? If you want.
No, it's okay. I tried that.
Okay.
Okay, so what you did there was you made two integers, okay, so A and B, then you took two inputs, right, and then you wanted to print one first integer, and then you wrote B, right? So what happens is that whenever you use a comma to separate two statements, they actually become two separate statements. Okay, so for example here, cout A is the first one and just B is the second statement. Okay, So if we compile this program, there will be no errors, right? So
I will just try it out. I understood what you are saying.
Okay, so if we just compile it, there will be no error. So what happened is that, just wait a minute.
अरे वेट वेट हाँ
सो जस्ट ऐड वन मोर सेमी कॉलम देयर एंड कंपाइल इट
वेयर शुड आई ऐड वन मोर सेमी कॉलम
हाँ ऑन लाइन 7 इट्स डन सो जस्ट कंपाइल इट
ओके सो आई कैन टेक द
सो इट्स ओके
I was also not sure if we could take the values of C in the comp. Guys, something interesting to know.
Use your own editor. You use Vim, right? Share your screen instead of. It will be more.
Easy. Yeah, you can
Is
share.
Is it your... visible? I have actually not started, but. Is it visible? My screen.
No, your screen is not visible, Gaurav.
Okay.
Guys, as you can see, I also get to learn along with you guys because I didn't know we can take like I actually forgot because I have been using Python for last 1 year. I'm also not like able to recall what C++ syntax is. Guru, I am not sure if the comma thing works, but this definitely does. Like, if instead of comma, if we are putting the extraction operator again, then it would work, right? Hello. Has Guru left the meeting? I guess there was some issue of network.
Yeah, he's coming. He's refreshing the tab and coming again.
So, okay. Yeah. Just a minute. You guys can wait. Yeah. Okay, till then I will give you guys one problem. A simple one. I guess I had taken it last time too, but let's see. What would be the output? Like, what would C give as an output? You guys can write it in the chat box. Okay, I'm just yeah. Sorry. Yeah. You guys can see it now, right? Int C equal to 4 + 3 × 5. C out C. What would be the answer? I will type it in the chat box too. Okay, so most of you guys know that BODMAS is followed in C++2, right, yeah. Okay, till Gavro joins, let's cover one more thing then. Right, 19 is the answer because the multiplication would work first and then we will add 4 value to it. So 5 into 3 will happen first, that is 15 plus 4 equal to 19. Great. So let's learn about one more operator quickly till Gavro joins. Okay, not integer. Some error, unvalid operands to binary expression. What would be the output? What do you guys think? If I'm initializing one Boolean variable as true, second one as false, and I'm using the AND operator. Like, I know I haven't taught this, but what do you guys think? What would be the output? False. Or would it be zero? What do you guys think? False or zero? Right. Okay, let's compile and see. Right, as most of you guys guessed it correctly, it is false. So, like, this is basic AND operation. You guys might have learned it in 11th and 12th, what AND operation is, right? So if both the variables are true, then the output would be true, else the output is false. So here, as one variable was false, so we got an output of false. Right, most of you guessed it correctly. Okay, Gaurav, you have joined, right?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so actually I can't present because when I click on present, my PC actually freezes and I don't know why. It does not happen on Meet, but on this platform basically. So can you please code?
Okay.
So just write.
Write this.
Do you have a local compiler?
Yes, I do have.
So just paste the code here afterwards, okay? So
yeah.
And yeah.
Right?
Okay.
This is what?
Yes. Just remove the code on line 7.
Line 7.
And then copy and then paste it in the local compiler.
Okay. Like this?
Yes. So save it and compile and let's see if we can get some errors.
Okay. Guys, this is some operating system called as Ubuntu. So those who are using Windows, don't get scared of this because you guys would be using this after some years or maybe in some months actually.
Add.cpp.
Add, sorry.
Actually it did not give any errors here because the version of G++ is different on your local machine and on the ripple.it server. Okay, so
right.
So what happens in that code, now you can open that editor.
Right.
What happens is that when you write two statements and give a comma between them, both of them get executed. So you can write C in A comma C out A. So just write that and compile.
C in A comma.
C out A.
A.
Yeah.
Write this, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Great. That's work.
So comma can be used to separate things. So when you first wrote the code, right? So C in A comma B, and then you had something like C out A plus B, right? So what happens is that if you don't write two statements side by side of the comma, so the compiler actually throws error on the next line.
Okay. Yeah.
So.
Right. I got. Yeah. Got it. So we can write basically using comma as well, right?
Yeah. Yes.
I actually knew this, but I forgot. since I was not familiar with it.
And also, this compiler uses Clang. It does not use G++. So some things may be different on local machines and on this website.
Right. Yeah, got it. So as you guys saw that C inputting variable by say in A comma B worked on my local machine, but didn't work on ripple.it, right? So that are you an iOS user? No, I'm not an iOS user. So we can use that statement, like say in A comma B, when we are writing the code on our local machine, because that would be the right addition of G++ on our node, right? So we can use that. Okay, my part is actually over. So Yatish will start. So he will be covering if and else statement. So what we learned regarding, like we learned about the operators, what data types are, what a Boolean value is, that would be used in if and else statement. So when you have to make a decision, when you want to make a piece of code work, only when a certain condition is true. For example, if the answer is greater than 5, you want to execute this statement. And if it is not greater than 5, then you want some other part of the code to execute. So how to write this type of code, that would be taught by Yatish. So thank you guys listening for me, patiently listening to me. And I hand over the session to Yatish.
Thanks, Vinod. I'll just share my screen.
Yeah.
Can somebody just confirm if they're able to see the screen?
Yatish.
Okay, hi guys. My name is Yatish Kakar and I'm currently in third year IT. So I'll be covering decision making and loops in C++ today. So the first question is, why do we need decision making or loops in while programming? So what happens is that sometimes when we are coding, right, we need to execute some code if and only if some condition is met. So what this means is that while executing, our program has to make a decision on whether to execute that code or not. So to do this, we use the if statement in C++. So this is how an if statement will generally feel like. If some condition is true, then we execute some code. And if that condition is not true, then we simply do something else. So this is how the syntax for the if statement is. We first write the keyword if. You guys can see that it's written in purple because it's a reserved word. After that, inside a pair of curly braces, we specify some sort of a condition. And after that, inside a pair of curly braces, we can write some code or any kind of program statements which we want to execute. These statements will be executed if and only if the condition that we mention here is true. So when the program is executing and if the if keyword is encountered, after that the program will check this condition. If the value of this condition evaluates to be true, then it will execute whatever code we have mentioned inside these curly braces. So to demonstrate that, let's actually just see a quick example. So you guys can code along with me or you can just watch either way. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to say if, and after that I'm going to open a pair of round brackets and I'm going to mention a very simple condition. For example, let's say 3 is less than 5. And after that, I'm going to open a pair of curly braces. I'm going to simply print out something. So I'm going to say something like the condition is true. So that's it for the if statement. So when our program will actually execute and when we get to this line, that is the sixth line, the compiler will check this condition, whether 3 is less than 5. So we know that this condition is true, right? Because 3 is less than 5. So because of that, the whatever code that we have written inside these curly brackets will get executed. So let's try running this program. So yes, we get the output that this condition is true. So this is all about if really. This is one of the most easiest programming constructs in C++, the if statement. And you will be using this a lot, whether you're coding for competitive coding or even for your college programs. So yes, After this, let's say you want to print something if the condition is not true. So we saw that in the if statement, we put a condition in the round brackets, and if it is true, then the code is executed, right? But if we want some code to be executed if the opposite happens, then we can simply write an else keyword. And similar to how we did here, we can put some code inside a pair of curly braces. So what happens is that during program execution, if this condition is false, then the compiler simply skips all the code that is written between these two brackets and directly goes to execute all the code that is there between the brackets that are there after the else statement. So to make this easier, what we'll do here, after this, we'll just type in else, open up another set of curly braces, and we'll just print another message that is opposite to the first one. So we'll say that the condition is false. And here I'll just change it a little bit. I'll say 7 is less than 5. So what will happen when the program is executing on the 6th line, it will check this condition. So we know that this condition is false because 7 is not greater, less than 5, right? It is greater than 5. So when the condition is false, it will simply skip whatever is written here and will directly proceed to check if there is an else statement. Now, since we have an else statement here, it will execute whatever code that we have put inside these curly braces. So if we say run, we get the output that the condition is false. So this is all about the if else part. So we are going to just try a very simple program now. We'll be writing a program to see, to check numbers and print out whichever number is bigger. So let's say we have two numbers, integer n1 and n2, and let's assign some values to them. Let's say n1 is 3 and n2 is 10. So what we have to do inside the if statement, now we need to specify a condition. So we want to check which number is larger, right? So we can simply say if n1 is greater than n2, and inside the curly braces, we can simply say number is greater. So that's all. And after that, if we want to print the opposite, right? So if the first number is actually smaller than the second one, then we can just print the opposite thing. So let's run this code. So we get that the second number is greater because the second number is what? N2, and N2 is greater than N3. So the if else is actually a really, really simple part of programming, and you'll be using this a lot. So one more thing, sometimes what happens is that you're not satisfied with just two conditions, right? So if this condition is true, then you execute this part. And if it is false, then you execute this part. But what happens if you want a third condition? So what we can do is I'll just comment out this. And let's say I want to write a program that detects whether a number is less than 10 or whether it's less than 100 or whether it's greater than 100. So let's say int num is equal to, let's say 200. So the first condition that I can mention, if num is less than 10, simply print num is less than 10. The next condition, suppose I want to check whether it is less than 100. So now what I can do is I can write else, and after else I can immediately write another if. And the same way as we had done before, we can open another pair of round brackets and we can specify another condition. Like for example, I'm writing here if num is less than 100. And then we can print out another statement. Here we are writing that a num is less than 100. And if both of these conditions are false, and if you want to execute a statement, if you want to execute some code at the last, then you simply say else, see out, num is greater than 100. So what happens here actually is that when this program is running, right, it will first encounter this. It will check whether the condition is true. This condition is obviously false because 200 is certainly not less than 10. So it will skip this part. After that, it will check this part. Is the number lesser than 100? No, then it will again skip this part. And after this, there is absolutely no condition. So this part will be executed. So let's try to run this. So we get an output that the number is greater than 100. So this is also something that you'll be using quite commonly. We'll take another example, and for that we'll try to use something that Vinod taught you just some time ago. So I need you guys to go to www.slido.com. So you can open another tab in your browser and you can go to this site called slido.com, and there you have to enter this code that you can see on the bottom left, 49330. And if some of you guys don't want to do all the typing, you can also take out your mobile and scan this QR code using your camera, and you can answer this question. This question will help us figure out the next example. So one person has answered this, 4. You guys can open another tab in your browser and go to slido.com. It will ask you to enter a code and you can enter 49330. So yes, almost 10 people have answered the question. Okay, so let's see the answer now. So yeah, almost 82% of you have given the correct answer, that this operator actually gives us the remainder, right? So when you divide A by B, what you get from as a result is the remainder. And this is something that will be used to code the next problem. So what we are going to see is we are going to test whether a given number is odd or even. So let's say we have a variable called number and we assign it some value of say 20. So now we want to check whether this number is even or odd. So we will obviously be using an if statement for that, because this is where our program needs to make a decision, right? And we'll open a set of curly braces. And now inside the round braces for the condition part, what we will do is that we will say if number modulo 2 is double equal to 0. So what this actually means is that when you divide a number by 2, right, if the number is odd, you will always be getting a remainder as 1. But if the number is even, the remainder will always be 0, right? Because all even numbers are divisible by 0. So when you evaluate this and the remainder is 0, we simply compare it to 0. So if this condition turns out to be true, then what it means is that our number is even. So we'll just print out even. Let's say the number is odd. So in the else part, we'll simply say odd. So let's execute this and see. Yeah, so we get the correct output, that is even. Now let's say we change this value to 21. Now we get the correct output, that is odd. So this was all for the if and else statement. So does anybody have any doubts about this? You can put it in the Q&A section or the chat. Okay, just a request to everybody, please don't call us sir. We are actually just 2 or 3 years older than you, senior to you, so you can call us by our name, it's completely fine. Okay, so the next part that we'll be seeing are loops. So the first question is, why do we need loops? What is a loop actually? So loop is something that that means just doing something over and over again. That is, we keep doing the same thing again and again. What it means in programming is that it means that we are running the same piece of code many times. For example, you want to print hello world to the console like 100 times. So there's two ways you can do that. You can either write a cout statement 100 times, or you can write a cout statement once and execute the same statement 100 times. So obviously everybody will prefer the second one, right? I mean, nobody wants to write 100 lines of code. So that is exactly why we use loops in C++. So we'll be looking at three types of loops that are there: the while loop, the do while loop, and the for loop. So the while and the do while loop are relatively simple. The for loop is slightly difficult, but don't worry, I'll try to explain it as best as I can. So we'll start with the while loop first. So a few minutes ago, we saw the syntax for the if statement, right? So we write the keyword if, and if the condition is true, then we execute whatever is there inside the code, inside the curly braces. In the same way, in the while loop, we write the keyword while, and inside that we mention a condition. And after that, inside these pair of curly braces, we write some code. So whenever our program is executing and it detects this while word keyword, it checks the condition. If this condition is true, then it will execute whatever code that we have written inside these brackets. And when this code has finished executing, it will come to this point. And at this point, it will go back to the top and check the condition again. Now, if this condition is still true, it will still run this code again. And at the end, it will again go back to the top. Now, at this point, let's say the condition becomes false. So if it becomes false, it will simply skip all this part and go to the end. So while loop is really simple to understand and execute. So let's try a simple program with that too. So I'm going to just delete whatever we had done previously. And let's say you want to write a simple loop to print all numbers from 0 to 9. So let's say we declare a variable called I and assign it the value as 0. So for a while loop, we will first write the keyword while, and then inside a set of round brackets, we will try to provide a condition. So let's say if while I is less than 10. So this is a condition, right, which will either give us a true value or a false value. After that, we'll, in a set of curly braces, we'll just print whatever the value of I is. So right, this is a very simple four-line while statement, and let's try to execute this now. So do you see the output? Why is it always zero? And you can see that the output just keeps on going, right? So what we have done actually is that we have entered into an infinite loop. So this will just keep on executing. And the problem is that in this loop, we are checking if the value of I is less than 10, which is true, right? And this part keeps executing. But the problem is that once this part has executed and we go back to the top, the condition still remains true because we are not changing the value of I. The value of I is always remaining zero, right? So it will always be less than 10. Which is why we are entering into an infinite loop, so a loop that will never end. So this is something that is really common when you program, and this is something we ourselves have experienced a lot of times. So you really need to avoid this kind of error because it's really frustrating to correct this. So now what we have done is that after printing out the value of I, we have simply incremented the value. So if we run the program again, see, we get the output of all the numbers right from 0 up to 9. So what is happening is that initially the value of I is 0. Then when we come at this point, it checks the condition. So 0 is less than 10, yes. So we execute this part. At the end of this, we are incrementing the value of I. So the value of I is now 1. So we again check this part. 1 is still less than 10. So we again execute this. So this keeps on going until the value of I is 9. Now 9 is still less than 10, right? So we will execute this, and after that the value of I becomes 10. So when we come back here and we check this will actually return false because 10 is not less than 10, right? It is 10 is equal to 10. So because of that, this will not be executed and the loop will end. So this is all about the while loop. Are there any doubts up till now? Okay, great. So we'll also have a look at the next kind of loop, that is the do while loop. The do while loop is really, really similar to the while loop, except that it has one important change from the while loop. So what happens in do while loop is that first we execute whatever code is that is written inside these curly brackets. And once this code has been executed, only then we check this condition. So what happens because of that is that if whatever code that we write inside these brackets always gets executed minimum one time. So when the program our program is executing, it will first execute this once, and after it's done, it will check the condition. If the condition is true, it will again go back up, execute it, and again check the condition. And if it is false, it will simply proceed onwards without doing anything. So we saw some time ago how to print all the numbers from 0 to 9, right? So let's try doing that with a do while. So I'll comment this out, rather delete it. I will say do. Inside a pair of curly braces, I will again print out the value of I. We'll increment the value of I so that we don't go into an infinite loop. After that, after the while, inside a pair of round brackets, I will again specify the condition that I needs to be less than 10. When we execute this, we again get the same output, right? 0 to 9. So what happens is that do while works essentially just like while, except that it executes at least one time. In the case of a while loop, it is possible that the loop might not execute at all, because the condition is always false. But in the case of do while, that such a thing will not happen. It will execute at least once, and after that, if the condition remains true, only then it will execute. Otherwise, it will just continue with the rest of the program. So yeah, we covered the two easy loops, that is the while and the do while loop. So let's get to the third part of loop, which is the for loop. Now, syntax-wise, the for loop might seem a little bit confusing or difficult. And that is because a for loop involves some things called as initialization, condition, and update. So what this basically means is that initialization means in the while loop, we wrote that integer I equal to 0, which means that we were assigning that variable some initial value, right? So in the for loop, we do that inside these round brackets instead of doing it outside. So that's the only real difference here. The next part that you need to mention is the condition. So in the while loop, we mentioned the condition in those round brackets, right? It is exactly the same in this case. The condition remains completely same. And the third part is update. So in the while loop, in the last line of the loop, we wrote something called as I++, which means that we were incrementing the variable every time the loop ran. So here we do the same thing, except that we don't write it at the end of our code statements. We simply mention it as a third parameter inside these brackets. So we saw some time ago how to print 0 to 9, right, using while and do while. So let's see if we can do it with for as well. So we'll comment this out. And inside for, what I will do is first I will initialize the value of I to 0. Then I will mention the same condition that we did for while loop. So I less than 10 and I plus plus. I will do the same thing that we had done previously. I will simply print out the value of I. If you notice here, I'm not including this I plus plus statement after the cout. This is because we have already mentioned it here. So that is one advantage of for loop, that whatever configuration is required for the loop that stays within these round brackets. So let's try to run this code. And again, we get the same output that we had previously. That is, we print all the numbers from 0 to 9. So for loop is sometimes difficult to understand or confusing because of the syntax that is there here. But when you're actually programming, you will realize that using a for loop is sometimes more easier than using a while or a do while loop. So it really depends on the kind of programs that you are writing. So based on that, you will be able to decide what kind of loop do you want to use. Do you want to use a for loop or a while loop? Or sometimes you might even want to use a do while loop. Although that's rare, but in our college assignments, at least, we sometimes do require to use these kind of loops. So are there any doubts up to this point? Okay, guys, so that was all from my side. Rutuja will be taking over from now. Thank you, guys, for bearing with me.
Okay. So I won't be presenting or teaching you anything, but there's this one thing. We've created this form, certificate form, and those who want the certificate for this session that you all have completed the C++ bootcamp, under the brand Google Developer Students Club, you all have to fill this form. It is actually a feedback form. And I'll share this. Hello?
Can hear you.
Okay. I just repeated everything on muted. Okay. So there's nothing I'm going to be teaching you right now, but there's this form that we have created. It's a Google form, certificate form. If you want the certificate that you all have attended this session, CPP Bootcamp under the brand Google Developer Students Club, you all have to fill this form. It is actually a feedback form. It's you all need to fill it by the end of the day. And yeah, that's it. Prashant, can you take over now?
Yeah, sure. So let me share my screen. Is it visible? Hello?
Yes, it's visible.
Yeah, thank you. Hello, my name is Prashant. I'm from B Computer, and I will be teaching you arrays in C++. Okay, so let's get started. So let's say I have created four variables like int A, then B, then C and D. Okay, now let's give them some values. A equal to 10, B equal to 20, C equal to 30, and D equal to 40. Now, these are all are of so we have four variables here, right? So if you want to print all these values, so we can just simply write cout A, B, C, and D. Okay, but what if I want all these values in a single variable? So I want all this A, B, C, D in a single element. So that's how the arrays came into pictures. So what is an array? So it is a collection of elements. So we can we can insert multiple values in an array. So let's see how we can create an array. So first we need to specify the data type of an array. So int and then the name of array. So let's say I've created z. Then after that we need to specify the square brackets. Okay, so that's how we can create an array. Now inside the square bracket we need to specify the size of an array. So let's say I want to create a array of size 10, so I can specify size as 10. And if I want to if I want the size of an array as only 2, so then I can write z of 2. So let's say I want to my array as 10, 20, 30 and 40. So then I need to create an array of size 4. All right, now we have created an array. Now we need to insert element inside our array. So before that we need to know how is the indexing inside an array. So 10 is located at first position, 20 is at second position, 30 is at third position, and in C++ the indexing start from zero. What I mean is the 10 is located at zeroth position, 20 is located at first position, and 30 is located at third position, and 40 is located at second position, and 40 is located at third position. So now if I want to insert 10 at zeroth position, so then I need to write z of 0 equal to 10. Similarly, if I want to insert 30, so z of 2 equal to 30. Then if I want to insert 20 at first position, so z of 1 equal to 20. And last, if I want to insert 40 at third position, so z of 3 equal to 40. Now let's try to print this array. So it is as similar as we print an variable. So cout z. But here we need to specify the position at the location of which we want to print the array. So let's say I want to print the first element of an array. So I will write z of 0. So now let's run our code. So I'll just comment it out. Okay, so it has printed 10 on. Now if I want to print a value at let's say third position, so I'll write a z of 3, and now if I run my code, I'll get 40. So but now I want all my elements to be printed online, printed on the console. So now we can use for loop, which has been taught by Yatish. So now I will create an for loop. For first I need a incrementing variable. So let's say I created a variable as int I, which starting from 0, then so I equal to 0 to I less than or equal to 3 and I plus plus. Then I just simply see out z of I. So in the first iteration, the value of I would be 0, right? So so z of 0 is what is z of 0 is 10. So we will get 10 printed. Next time the I will increment, and the I value becomes 1. So z of 1 will be 20. So 20 will be printed on the line, and so 30 and 40. So let's run this code. Okay, just a minute. So here we are. So we get 10, 20, 30, and 40. So now we have created an integer array, right? So we can also create a float array, then character array, then double, and so on. That is different types of data types of array. So before that, I need to change the definition. So I said that array, it is a collection of elements, but it is a collection of similar type of elements. So I cannot insert a value other than the type which I specified. So if I write like z of 0 equal to 5.678 like this, so I will get an error because I can't insert other than the integer type. So I need to only insert the type as int. So okay, so any questions till now? Please type in whether you have understood it or not. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Prashant, just a minute. There's this question in the Q&A that could you please guide us about how to get started with Ubuntu, the Linux system? So we'll be taking a short meeting. Gaurav will be taking a short meeting after this, and he'll take a 10-minute tour for y'all. And he'll.
But it's actually not compulsory. Those who want to learn about Linux and that, those can join on this. I mean, it's not compulsory for all to join.
Send the Google Meet link in 5 minutes. Y'all can join then. About question.
Okay then, let's continue. Gaurav, can you mute yourself?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Now let's create an character array. So we need to specify the data type, so char, ARR, and then the size. So let's say I want 5 elements in my array. One more thing, we can directly write values here itself. So I can write the values of my ARR in the curly braces itself. So I can write as H, comma, then E, comma, then L, comma, L, and O. So this is another way you can initialize an array. And similarly, using for loop, we can print it. So for, let me create an incremental variable. I equal to 0. So I 0, I less than or equal to 4, I plus plus, and then just simply see out AR of I. So yeah, we are getting output as hello. Okay, now this time what we'll do is we will take input from user and then we'll print on the console. So let me specify size as ARR of 5. This time let's say we will create a float array. Now, then for I in I start from 0 to I less than 4 and I plus plus. And scene ARR of I. After that, we can just simply print it for I equal to 0 to I less than or equal to 4 I plus plus, and then see out ARR of I. So let me give a message. Enter element at location. Then see out elements in array R so let me run this code. So enter element at 0th location, so let's say 20, first location let's say 23, second location 45, third location 21, at fourth location let's say 5. So we get elements in array 20, 23, 45, 21 and 5. Okay, awesome. Now can anyone tell me if I want to, if so this is my array ARR that is 20, 23, 45, 21, and 5. So if I want to access only, if I want to print only values from 23, 45, and 21, what should I initialize the value of 0? And what should be the condition? Can you please write it in chat box? So I want 23, 45 and 21. So what should be the value of I here and what should be the condition here? Okay, so yeah, right. So either you can specify as 0, 1, 2, 3, okay, so 20 23 45 21 5. Yeah, we get output as 23, 45 and 21, or you can write as I less than 4, both will work. Yeah, correct. So now let's see how this array is get stored inside a memory. Before that, let me tell you when we create an variable, so a comma b, this will get stored inside a memory wherever it filed as free space. So a might get address as 3000 and B might get at address, might stored at an address of let's say 4000, let's say 5000, but in case of array, the elements are stored in a contiguous memory locations. What I mean is that if I create an array like ARR of 5 and initialize it like 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, 4 and 5. So let's say my first element is located at an address of 2000. Then my next element would be stored at a location of 2004, because as we know that integer takes 4 bytes. So array of 0 is stored at since array of 0 is stored at 2000 location, so it would be stored, so ARR of 1 would be stored at 2000 plus 4, that is 2004 memory address. So just let me share me another window. Yeah, so let's say I have created an array which includes 11, 9, 17, 89 and etc values, and my starting address of my ARR of 0 is 200. Then the value 9 would be stored at an address of 2004. Similarly, my second index element would be stored at 2008, and this continues till the last element. Okay, just a minute. Okay, that's how the array got stored inside the memory. So any doubt in this? Yeah, thank you. So now let's try to print what would the length of an array. So now we know that my length of array is 5 here. But what if I initialize as ARR of 10. So my size of my array is 10. But we only have 5 elements in my array, so my actual size of my array is 5. So in C++ there is an operator called size of operator. So this will return the actual size held by that variable. So it will return as integer takes 4 bytes, so integer takes 4 bytes, and we have total 5 elements. So size of operator will return me 20 as output. So how do I get the length? So I can just simply write size of my array. Size of my array divided by size of integer, that is size of my first element. So let's try. So cout size of Sorry guys, someone was at the door. So let's continue. So size of my ARR, that is my array, divide by size of int. So now let's see what it prints. Okay, 10. Gauru, can me help me why it is printed 10? Hello, Gauru, are you there?
Yes, Prashant, because you allocated the memory of 10 for array. Like you have initialized the array of size 10, right?
Yep. Yeah, right. Yeah,
therefore.
Okay, so now I'll get answer as 5. Yeah, here we are. Now let's try to program. Let's try to find out maximum from an array. So let's say I have created an array like, or else we can take it from user. So I'll tell the what would be the logic. So let's say I have an array like, my array is 23, 45, then 56, 10, and 23. Now, what I want is, I want to find the maximum from an array. So we can, as we can see that the maximum is 56. But how do we know, how should we program so that we can get 56? So what we can do is, we can create a variable, call it max, and we can store the value the value of the first element of an array. So here we can store it. We can get the first value of an array is 23. So max will be 23. Now we're gonna check if this max is this maximum is lesser or the greater than the elements of other elements of ARR. So if found an maximum element other than the this max variable, then we gonna assign that value to the max and increment till the and iterate over the array. So let's program it. So int ARR of 10. Then in I, then for I sort from 0 to take only 5 values to I less than 4, I plus plus. We're gonna take it from user. So scene ARR of I. After that, let's just print the value of an array. So see out. ARR of I. Now, as we said, we need a variable. So let's say we create a variable max and store the value of of first element, so error of zero. Then we're gonna loop it through our array. So I'll start from 0 to I less than 4 and I plus plus, and we check if my max variable is lesser than the error of I, and just simply my max should be my error of I, and then we can print it like cout. Max is max. So let's first me try whether it is working or not. So let's give value as 23, 45, 56, 10, and 23. So our array is, as I have mentioned it here, array is printed and the max is 56. Now let's see how the program is working. So initially my max is set to 23, right? Here I have declared it as max equal to error of 0, that is 23. On the first iteration, my max is checking condition with error of 0, that is 23. So this is false, so it won't get inside here. Now after that, my max becomes, sorry, error of I becomes 45. So 23 is less than 45, so it will go inside the if condition, and my max becomes 45. Now on the next iteration, so max is 45, which is checking with error of I, that is now it is 56. Now this condition is true, so again my max will change and my max will become 56. After that, my error of I becomes 10 and it is checking with 56, so this is false, so it won't go inside this condition and my max will become as 56 as it is. After that, my max error of I changes and it changes to 23, and the condition is still false, then so it will come out of loop and it will print max as 56. Yeah, so that it is. So any doubts in this? So Shruti is asking, if we don't know the limit of array, can we found max number or what will be the output? So you mean to say that if limit means the length or what? I didn't get your question. Okay, so you, okay, length. So we can calculate the length as size of error upon the size of int, and then we can assign that value to the another variable, and then we can just place that variable here like length, and then we can find the maximum element from array. Okay. So now let's go to slido.com and we will be having a quiz. Just a minute, let me share my screen. Okay, so go to slido.com and enter this code 371762. So first question. Single array can have different data types element such as int, char or float. Okay, so 7 people have voted. Okay, so most of you have guessed it correctly. So it is false, because when we create array, we specify the data types like int error of 5. So there itself we specify the data type of an array. So we can't insert values other than the data type which we specified. Okay, so next question. If my error of 5 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so what would be the value of error of 2? Okay. So about 96% people guessed it correctly. So it is 3, because as we know that the array index didn't start from 0. So if you want to get the element which is at n position, so you need to specify the index as n minus 1. So if I want error of 2, means so if I want as 3 as my output, so I need to specify error of 2. Okay, so next question. So if my error of 4 is 10 20 30 40, then what is the value of error of 1 plus error of 3? Yes, so the correct answer is 60, as error of 1 is 20 and error of 3 is 40. So 20 plus 60 is 20 plus 40 is 60. Okay, so next question. Assuming int is of 4 bytes, what is the size of int of error of 10? Okay, so here correct answer is 40, because 10 elements in our array, right? So each element takes 4 bytes. So 10 into 4, that is the correct answer is 40. Okay, so that's all from arrays. So do you have any doubts in array? Yeah, thank you. So I'll stop sharing my screen. Yeah, hand it. So Rutuja, please continue.
Okay, thank you for the session, all the hosts and all the attendees. Now about the Google Meet, I'm sending the link to y'all in the chat section. Y'all can join, whereby Gaurav and some other people will tell you about Linux system, transitioning to Linux. Y'all can join.